Welcome to HSC Economics Made Easy. This video is part of a series on the topic of income and wealth distribution. Previously, we learned some definitions, measurements, as well as some trends related to income and wealth inequality. I'll have a link to that in the description below. Today, we'll be exploring the economic and social impacts of income and wealth inequality.
The first problem from an economic point of view is that inequality generally worsens over time. This is because high-income earners often have higher skills, which gives them greater bargaining power to further increase their wages at a greater rate than low-income households. Furthermore, high-income households have a greater ability to put their incomes into assets, which then increase their wealth. This wealth can then be used to generate greater income, which further perpetuates the income and wealth gap. When income and wealth is concentrated to high-income households, it can reduce overall utility, which is the satisfaction derived from consumption. This is because they're more likely to spend larger amounts of money, but might not get a proportional increase in satisfaction, which then becomes a waste of resources. This loss of utility can also be attributed to conspicuous consumption, which is when consumers spend money on luxury goods and services just to show off their affluence. To give an example, a poor household can buy a $10,000 car and get them from point A to point B, and that gives them complete utility. A richer household could spend 10 times more than that and get a $100,000 car, but would they really get 10 times the utility? Probably not. So that's how resources concentrated to high wealth households lead to reduced overall utility in the economy. Also, high income earners have a higher tendency to save, or a higher NPS. So when high income earners are given an even higher concentration of money, a higher proportion of this income goes towards savings. As you remember from the circular flow of income, savings is a leakage, and this could lead to a contraction in the economy. The next economic problem that income inequality could cause is that low-income earners could end up in poverty. And with poverty comes other economic problems, such as increased debt. This could in turn lead to debt traps, which is the situation in which a debt becomes impossible or difficult to repay. This is typically when the interest repayments get so high that the borrower struggles to repay that, let alone the loan principal. In order to make sure low-income households can stay out of poverty and satisfy their wants and needs, the government may need to play a larger role in providing transfer payments. Increased expenditure for social welfare means that the government will need to collect more revenue in the form of taxes. Larger roles of government is also often associated with a lack of allocative efficiency in the economy.
So those are some of the economic costs. Let's now look at some of the social costs.
As mentioned previously, there is a higher likelihood of poverty, and that leads to a range of human well-being issues, such as debt, crime, as well as physical and mental health issues. A widened gap between the rich and poor can also lead to social class divisions, and the differences can lead to discrimination and unrest. And these social costs obviously incur economic costs too.
There's another side of the debate. Some may argue that income and wealth inequality is not really a problem, because with income differentials, there are some economic benefits.
An economy with high income and wealth inequality usually enjoys the incentive effect. In these economies, the only way to earn a higher income is by being a more valuable and productive employee. So there's the incentive to be more productive. Think about the other extreme. If everyone is getting equal rates of income anyway, then why push yourself and be more productive than the next worker? Income differentials incentivize productivity. And productivity benefits the economy as it increases aggregate supply, improves international competitiveness, lowers prices so everybody in the economy can enjoy a higher standard of living. So how do you increase your productivity and value as a worker? One way is through education and training. Not only does this lead to the above economic benefits, but improved skill sets lead to lower structural unemployment and more occupational mobility. Along with working harder and increasing productivity, workers are also incentivized to work longer hours, as that could lead to higher income brackets. Income differentials could also lead to entrepreneurship or self-employment. For example, if a worker is discontent with his or her income levels at their existing job, this worker could respond by using their skills to start their own business so that they could keep all the profits to themselves. This new business can contribute to innovation and consumer choice in the economy. Related to this is that existing business owners might be discontent with low income, and this could lead to them investing and expanding their businesses. Again, this leads to innovation and consumer choice. Investment also leads to efficient production methods and increased aggregate supply. Do you remember what labor force mobility means? It means that the labor force is more responsive to structural change, such as changes in consumer demand or technology. Income differentials signal and incentivize workers to leave declining industries and work for industries where there is consumer demand. My last economic benefit actually builds off a point that I made earlier about economic costs. Theoretically, the savings ratio will increase if income is concentrated towards high-income households. The economic cost of this is increased leakages in the economy, but there are benefits of higher savings ratios too. For example, increased savings could mean that the cost of borrowing to invest could fall, and there's a multitude of benefits that can come from increased investment. Also, a higher savings ratio means that we don't have to rely on foreign liabilities to fund domestic investment, so this could lead to improved external stability.
Lastly, let's talk about social benefits. There really aren't a lot of social benefits that stand alone from the economic benefits, but I'll try to highlight some of the social benefits anyway.
Most of the economic benefits of income differentials stem from the incentive effect. Individuals are incentivized to work harder and longer to upskill, invest, and innovate, and so on. These lead to many economic benefits for society as a whole, but it also leads to a greater sense of personal achievement. It can be far more rewarding for an individual to know that their standard of living improved as a result of their own hard work and decisions, as opposed to government programs. Lastly, inequality with the absence of government intervention can give a greater role for charity, which can feel rewarding for the donor and foster positive social connections.
I hope that my explanations and examples have made it easier for you to understand the economic and social impacts of income and wealth inequality. If this video has helped you, please leave a like and comment, as well as share the video too. Don't forget to subscribe to the channel, as well as follow us on Facebook to make sure you don't miss any future videos. I look forward to continuing to make HSE economics easy for you. See you next time.